where we've come, for strangers must inquire of citizens, and who is they of being?
Long-suffering Father Oedipus, the towers of Pentacity city still are faint and far, but where we stand is surely holy ground, though wilderness of laurel all is divine, for within, fire of nightingales and warbling, on this native seat throughout the rest, for an old man who travels far.
Guide these dark steps and see me there secure. Do you know where we are?
Athens I recognize, but not the spot.
That much we heard from every wayfarer.
But shall I go on and ask about the place?
Yes, daughter, you can be an Athens.
A woman comes.
Oh, stranger! As I learn from her, whose eyes must serve both her and me, that you are here.
You must not sit there. The spot you tread is holy ground.
What is the site? To what god dedicate?
Inviolable, untrod goddesses, dread brood of the earth and darkness hereby, the gracious ones. All seeing, so our hope call them. But elsewhere they are known by less hospitable names.
Then may they show their suppliant grace, for I, from this your sanctuary, will never depart.
What is this?
The watchword of my fate. Now in heaven's name, O stranger, scorn me not. As a wayfarer, tell me what I pray.
Ah, your request shall not be scorned by me.
You say there are dwellers in these parts.
Surely.
Ruled by a king or by the general voice?
The Lord of Athens is our overlord.
Who is this monarch, great in word and might?
Theseus, son of Aegeus, our late king.
Might one be sent you to summon him?
Wherefore? To tell him aught or urge his coming?
Say, a slight service may avail him much.
How can he profit from an old, sightless man?
The blind man's words will be instinct with sight.
Speak then. I fain would see you out of harm, for by your looks, marred though they be, I judge you noble. Stay where you are while I go seek those at hand. They will soon decide whether you are to rest or go your way.
Tell me, my daughter, has the stranger gone?
Yes, now we are all alone. We speak, Father, without fear.
Stern-visaged queens, since coming to this land first from your sanctuary, I bend the knee. Frown not on me or Phoebus, who, when he told me all my miseries to come, spoke this respite after many years. Some haven. In a far-off land, a rest vouchsafed at last by dread divinity. There, said he, shall you round your weary life. Blessing to the land wherein you dwelt, but to the land that cast you forth, a curse. And he promised signs should come, earthquake or thunderclap or lightning flash. And now I recognize as yours the sign that led my wanderings to this, your grove. Else had I never lighted on you first, a poor man on seat of native rock. O goddesses, fulfill Apollo's word. Grant me some consummation of my life. Here, gentle daughters of primeval night. Here, Athens, first of cities. Pity this ghost that once was.
Hush, for I see some more women on their way, their errand to spy out our resting place.
I will be mute. Guide my steps away from the public road until I have learned their draft.
Where is he?
Look around.
Every nook and corner scan.
He, the all-presumptuous man, where has he gone?
Search the ground.
A wayfarer, no countryman of ours, that old man must have been.
Never would a native dare to tempt the powers.
Or enter their domain.
The maids in awe of whom each mortal powers.
Whose name the voice betrays.
Whose image we pass with averted eye.
But now some godless man 'tis rumored here sits.
And yet I cannot find him.
I am the man you seek.
Oh, dread to see and dread to hear.
Who can he be?
You save us. This old man?
No favorite of fate is my enemy, though.
Evil, methinks, and long your pilgrimage on earth.
Yet add not curse to curse and wrong to wrong.
Trespass trapped not within the hollowed spot.
Come away, tired wanderer, come away.
Daughter, what counsel should we now pursue?
We must obey.
Your hand, then.
Here,
good people, I come forth at your command. Let me not suffer for my confidence.
Against your will, no man shall drive you hence.
But you would wish I go further.
Aye.
Young maiden, you can guide him where he will, can't you?
I will move him only at his command, if he is beggared and lost, but still my father. Wanderer, tell me of your birth and home.
From what far country are you come from?
I have no country. I dread my lineage. Must I answer?
Say of what stock you come from.
I plead for silence.
Come, sir, why dally thus?
Knowest one of Laius?
Who?
See.
Oh, Zeus!
The hapless Atlas.
Are you he?
Have no fear of me.
Be gone!
For your order,
speed you both away.
Banish not my blind father. Though you know the deeds he has wrought, and know he is not innocent, but yet always with no ill intent, he to maiden's pride pleads for him alone. My eyes, which yet can see, plead with you as a daughter's might. You are our providence. Oh, make us not go hence, but the gracious God grant us the boon we crave.
Surely we pity you and him alike.
But as we reverence the decrees of heaven, we cannot say aught other than we said.
What avails renown of fair repute? Are they not vanity? For look you now, Athens is held of states the most devout. Athens alone gives hospitality and shelters the vexed stranger, so men say. I found this one. I, whom you dislodged from my seat of rock and now would drive forth from your land, dreading my name alone. For me you surely dread not, nor my deeds. Deeds of a man more sinned against than sinning. Yet am I then a villain born because in self-defense? I pray you, lady, in heaven's name, even as you bade me quit my seat, defend me! Oh, pay not lip service to the gods and wrong them of their dues.
I plea you urge, needs must give us pause.
You make a weighty argument,
but we must leave the issue with the ruling powers.
Where is he, strangers, who sways the realm?
In his ancestral seat.
The high priestess who sent us here is gone from him.
And you think he will have such care of office? Come himself.
He will, once he learns your name.
He'll hear and haste and never fear.
So wide and far your name is noised abroad, that even if he were chained in place, he would break those chains and come running when he hears who waits for him.
Well, may he come with blessing to his state and me, who serves his neighbor, serves himself.
Zeus, what is this?
What now, Antigone?
I see a woman riding upon a horse. She wears a Thessalian hat to shade her from the sun. Can it be? Is it possible? Do I wake or dream? It is no other. Herself is Mene.
Oh, happy day, my child!
Father and sister, names to me most sweet. How hardly have I found you, and at last can see you through my tears.
My child, my youngest.
Father, how sad is your plight?
Touch me, my child.
I give a hand to both.
Oh, children, sisters.
Oh, disastrous plight.
What brought you, daughter?
Father, care for you.
The daughter's yearning.
Yes. And I have had news I would myself deliver, gathered from the camp of my brother.
Stubborn Polyneices. Are he and that treacherous Eteocles once again at war?
They are. Indeed, now their darkest hour approaches. Though in the wake of the sacrifice of Creon's son did Eteocles will to lead Prince Haemon the throne, thus thinking to remove the inveterate curse of old. The canker that infected all your children has stirred within them again, and renewed between the brothers the mad rivalry to grasp at sovereignty and kingly power. The banished brother has returned once more from Argos with new alliance and friends in arms, this time promising he will make the king of Argos lord of Thebes. This is no empty tale, the deadly truth, my father. Brother betrays my brother, who then betrays his own people once and for all.
When will the gods at last turn and rescue me?
That is also my news, for I read these latest oracles.
What oracles? What has been uttered, child?
Your country, so it runs, shall yearn in time to have you for their king once more, alive or dead.
And who could gain by such a one as I?
On you 'tis said their sovereignty depends.
So, when I cease to be, my worth begins.
The gods who once threw you down uplift you now.
For help to raise an old man fallen in youth.
However that be, it is for this cause alone that Creon comes to you, and comes soon.
With what intent, my brother? Tell me plainly.
to plant you near the Theban land, and so keep you within their grasp.
Plant me.
Your bones, father. Creon wants you buried on Theban soil.
But why?
So that he might be hailed the curse breaker of Thebes, and thus be ushered to power over both my brothers.
And who has told you what to tell me, child?
Envoys who visited the Delphic Oracle.
Has Phoebus spoke thus concerning you?
So say the envoys who were intercepted by the Polyneices.
And can a son of mine have heard this?
Yea, both alike, and know its import well.
They knew it! Yet the ignoble greed of rule outweighed all other sense.
Grievous are your words, yet I must own them true.
Then may the gods ne'er quench their fatal feud, and my life be the arbitrament of the fight for which they're now arming spear to spear. Let neither he who holds the scepter now keep his throne, nor he who fled the realm and promised it to a foreign king, return again. Polyneices never raised a hand when I, his sire, was thrust from hearth and home, when I was banned and banished by my own son. I am damned by heaven, it is true, but my sons, who should as sons have helped, have done nothing. One little word from them is all I need. They speak no words except the insults and vows declared at one another, and ever, always the throne, that wretched, cursed throne. In the corner of their eyes, in the front of their hearts, in the back of their minds. Sacrificed their sire for lust of power, and sceptered sovereignty they did. No! Me, they shall never win for an ally, nor will the Thebans forgive. Come, Creon. Come then, all the mightiest of Thebes, to seek me. My bones shall remain here, where at last I have found rest and shall go no further, dead or alive. I will not once more save the city that banished me, nor help my sons, nor hinder them, nor aid their uncle in his machinations. I am done! I shall stay now. And that is how the curse will last me.
Our pity, Oedipus, you and these maidens. Let us now counsel you.
Aid me, kind people. I will do all you bid.
First, make atonement to the deities whose grove by trespass you now profane.
Make a libation first of water fetched with undefiled hands from living spring.
Bowls you will find. Crown the rims with wool from fleece of yearling freshly shorn.
Pour the libation, turning to the dawn, in three streams, till the last bowl be drained to the last drop.
Water, and with honey. Add no wine.
And when the embowered earth has drank thereof.
Then lay upon it thrice nine olive sprays, with both your hands, and offer up this prayer, that as we call them gracious, they would deign to grant the suppliant their saving grace.
I cannot go, disabled as I am doubly, by lack of strength and lack of sight.
I will go perform these rites. Where to find the spot, this I have yet to learn.
Beyond this grove.
You have need of ox, the guardians of the shrine will lend you aid.
I go. Antigone, guard our father well.
Oh, bid me not expose my shame. On me, I pray you yield. On me, grant my request, I grant it all to you. I have suffered ills most vile, but none so help me heaven from acts and malice done. In all unwitting bridegroom, bound by impious marriage chain. It stabs me like a sword, that two-edged word, love. Two daughters, curses twain, their father's very sisters too. Two sons, cursed the same, princes, sorrow, and despair. Oh, intolerable woe, a plea of justice, a plea of mercy. Let me one day stand without a stain. Let those unstained yet stand after I find God.
Oft had I heard of you in times gone by, the bloody mutilation of your eyes, the murder of your father Laius. All that I lately gathered on the way made my conjecture doubly sure. And now your garb and that marred visage prove to me that you are he, O most ill-starred Oedipus. I fain would know what is the suit you urge on me in Athens, you and the helpless maiden at your side. Declare it. Dire indeed must be the tale. I too was reared, like you, in exile and in foreign lands, and wrestled with many perils and much adversity. And thus no man, but least of all you, shall seek my help in vain. I know myself a mortal, and what one mortal owes to another, so long as they both live in this world.
Theseus, your words are so generous, and need no long reply. Both who I am, what lineage sprung, and from what land I come, you know. So without prologue, I may utter now my brief petition, and the tale is told. I come to offer you this well-worn frame, a gift not fair to look on, yet it's worth more precious far than any outward show.
What profit do you proffer to have brought?
My very bones. My blessings on this land, which has forgiven me, and when I am dead and you have buried me, all I ask is proper burial.
The grace you crave is small indeed.
Nay, weigh it well. The issue is not slight. Creon would fain convey me back to Thebes.
I understand why. For you to rest in banishment is not fitting.
Nay, but when I wished to rest in my home, they would not consent. Oh, Theseus, I have suffered wrongs on wrongs. By my own flesh and blood, I was expelled my country, and now Creon seeks my return only because he hopes to use me against my own children.
Your children who betrayed you?
They are still my children. I will no more be used to overthrow them than I would be used to aid them in their foolish war. If pleas and tears and common decency will not stop them, then nothing shall. Let Creon pick what bones he can from the ashes when they are finished, but let him do so without my help. I am old and tired, and I will be old and tired even after I cease to breathe. Enforce not this last journey on me to a land where I am not welcome. Creon may claim all he likes by way of forgiveness, but in truth, he wants me there no more than my own sons do. And even if he did now, I see Thebes was never my home. I was born there, it is true. But I was cast out from the beginning. And the more I have tried to return, the more the land has cast me out, twisting every root and hewing every branch that would keep me there. If I am buried there, I am condemned, and so be the earth that holds me in its mouth, but will never swallow me. If I am buried here, I am forgiven. So be the land that absolves me of my sins and lets me at last sink into peaceful oblivion. Take me in, Lord, when all others have cast me out and fear me, and you shall be known as the one who took pity when no one else did. Take me in, Lord, without ulterior motive, and you shall be known as both merciful and true.
The man, my lord, has from the very first declared his power to offer to our land these benefits.
Who could reject the proffered amity of such a friend? First, he claimed the hospitality to which by mutual contract we stand pledged. Next, coming here, a suppliant to the gods, he pays full tribute to the state and me. His favors, therefore, never will I spurn, but grant him the full rights of citizen, and, if it suits him here to bide, I place him in your charge. Or, if he please, he may also come with me. Choose, Oedipus, whichever of the two you will. Your choice is mine.
Zeus, may your blessings fall on men like these.
What do you decide, then? To come with me?
Yea, were it lawful, but 'tis rather here I shall vanquish those who cast me forth.
Then your presence here was a boon indeed.
Such shall it prove if you fulfill my pledge.
Fear me not. I shall not play you false.
No need to back your promise with an oath.
An oath would be no surer than my word.
How will you act, then?
None shall hail you hence against my will. Such threats vented in anger often are blusterers, and idle breath forgotten sends returns. As for your foemen, though their words were brave, boasting to bring you back, they are like to find the seas between us wide and hard to sail. Such my firm purpose. But in any case, take heart. Since Apollo sent you here, my name, though I be distant, warrants you from harm.
You have come,
of you to make these glorious titles good.
Why this appeal, my lord?
Father, lo, Creon approaches with his company.
Fear not, it shall be so. If we are old, this country's vigor has no touch of age.
My noble friends and relations, you take alarm at my approach. I read it in your eyes. Fear nothing, and refrain from angry words. I come with no ill purpose. I am old, and know the city whither I am come, without a peer amongst the powers of Greece. For it is by reason of my ears that I was chosen to persuade your majesty and bring you back to Thebes, not the delegate of one man, but commissioned by the state. Since of all Thebans, I have most bewailed, being your kinsman, your most grievous woes. Oh, listen to me, luckless Oedipus, come home. The whole Theban people claim with right to have you back, I most of all. For most of all, elsewhere I vile indeed, I mourn for your misfortunes. Seeing you an aged outcast, wandering on and on, a beggar, with one handmaid for your guide. And who had ever imagined she could fall to such a depth of misery as this? To tend in penury, your stricken frame, though a virgin ripe for wedlock, but unwed. Seems it not cruel, this reproach I cast on you, and on myself, and all the race? Aye, but her open shame cannot be hid. Hide it. Oh, hide it, Oedipus. But you can't. Oh, by our father's gods, consent, I pray, come back to Thebes. Come to your home. Bid Athens as his meet a fond farewell. Thebes claims you first.
Oh, front of brass! Your subtle tongue would twist your advantage every plea of right. Why try your arts on me? In old days, when my self-wrought woes distraught, I yearned for exile's glad release. Your rule will refuse the favor that I craved. But when my frenzied grief had spent its force, and I was settled into the comfort of home, then my son thrust me from my country, and you, who should have stopped him, ignored those same ties of kindred you now flout.
You must forgive me, my king. My own son was dead in my arms, you must recall, and I was frozen with grief.
Wrap in soft words hard thoughts. You forget that your son died to save the state. The state you now claim to represent, and yet at the time you told him to flee while he might, so that no state was as worthy as his solitary life. So then, who do you serve, Creon? What pleasure motivates you to force friendship on unwilling allies? Suppose a man refused to grant some boon when you importuned him, and afterwards, when you had gotten your heart's desire, consented, granting a grace from which all grace had fled. Would not such favor seem an empty boon? Yet such the boon you offer me now. Fair in appearance, but when tested, false. Yea, for I know you are false, that you are come to take me, not to take me home. Not because of a longer, but because we'll make you a hero to people grasping at straws in their panic, as armies converge once again to annihilate the city. But you shall not gain from my passing. And for my sons, this heritage, no one. Just for them not to die. Now leave me here. Whatever may be my lot, I have nothing more to say to you.
Which loses in this parley? I overthrown by you, or you who overthrow yourself?
Only your suit fails with me.
Unhappy man, will years never make you wise? Must you live on to cast a slur on age?
You have a glib tongue, but no honest man, methinks, can argue on any side.
'Tis one thing to speak much, another to actually speak well.
Your words, forsooth, are few and well aimed.
Not for a man, indeed, with wits like yours.
Depart!
You will come with me, Oedipus.
And how shall you make me?
One of your daughters is already seized. The other I will carry off now. And this is but prelude to further woes if you do not cooperate.
Have you a child?
And soon shall have the other.
Oh, friends, play us not false. Chase us out, godly villain, from your land.
Hence, pay your hands not. You do wrong in this and wrong in all that you do.
If you will not come with me willingly, Antigone, I will have you carried by force.
Strangers of this land, protect me.
Sir, you do wrong.
Yea, right.
How right?
I take with what is mine.
Quick, Alexander, or we'll fight it out!
Heck, there's war with Thebes, if we are armed or shall no longer serve you for further roaming. Since it pleased you to triumph over your country and the destruction your two bad seeds bring upon it, enjoy your triumph. Sooner or later, you will find you are an enemy to yourself, both now and in time past. When it's despite the friendly offers, you gave rein to your passion, your true curse.
Goddesses, allow your suppliant to utter yet one curse. Wretch, now my eyes are gone, and you have torn away the helpless maiden who was eyes to me. For these to you and all your cursed race, may the great sun whose eyes is everywhere grant length of days and old age as miserable as mine.
Listen, O people of Athens, mark you this.
They mark us both and understand. I defend myself with words.
Nothing shall curb my will.
What are these cries for help I hear? What is going on here?
Dear friend, for I recognize your voice. That man has now done me a foul wrong.
What is this wrong? Speak.
Creon, who stands before you, has robbed me of my daughters. He would rob me of myself.
Hasten to the altars, one of you. Command my liegemen leave the sacrifice and hurry, foot and horse, with rein unchecked, lest I become a mockery to this my guest, as one despoiled by force, quick as I bid. As for this stranger, had I let my rage justly provoked have play, he shall not escape scatheless and uncorrected in my hands. Creon, you shall not quit this land till you have fetched some maidens and produced them in my sight. You have offended both against myself and your own race and country, having come to a state that champions right. You set aside the custom of the land and, like some thief, carry off what plunder pleases you, as if this were a city without men, and I no one of consequence. Yet not from Thebes this villainy was learnt. Thebes is not wont to breed unrighteous sons, nor would she praise you if she knew you were robbing me, I and the gods to boot.
Rather, I thought your people were not like to set such store by kin of mine and keep them against my will. Nor would they harbor, so I stood assured, a godless parricide, a reprobate convicted of incestuous marriage ties. For on her native hill of Ares here sits justice, and permits not vagrant folk to stay within your borders. In that faith, I hunted down my quarry, and even then I had refrained before the curses dire wherewith he slandered my kinsfolk and myself. Such wrong, we thought, had warned for my act. Anger has no old age, but only death. The dead alone can feel no touch of spite. So you must work your will. My cause is just, and I will try, old as I am, to answer deed with deed.
Oh, shameless railer. Think you this abuse defames my gray hairs rather than your own? Murder and incest, deeds of horror, all you blurt forth against me, all I have borne. So it pleased the gods, and in retribution I was doomed to trespass thus against myself and mine. Answer me now. If by some oracle my sire was destined to a bloody end by a son's hand, can this reflect on me? Me, that unborn, begotten by no sire, conceived in no mother's womb. And what if when born to misery as born I was, I met my sire, not knowing whom I met or what I did and slew him? How can you with justice blame the all unconscious hand? And for my mother, wretch, are you not ashamed she was your sister, to extort from me the story of her marriage? She was my mother. I knew it not, nor she. And she bare children to the son whom she'd borne. But I unwitting wed, unwilling speak. Nay, neither in this marriage or this deed which you are ever spitting in my face, a murdered sire, shall I be heard to held to blame. Come then, answer me one question, if you can. If one should presently attempt your life, wouldst you, O man of justice, first inquire if the assassin was perchance your sire, or turn upon him? As you love your life, on your aggressor you would turn, not stay debating, the law would bear you out. Such could he come back to life, my father would not disagree. Yet you, who sticks at nothing, if it serve his plea, reproach me with this before these people. It serves your turn to blacken my name, because I have been the plaything of fate.
And yet when fate told you to sacrifice your son, you bid him run! I did not condemn this. I would have done the same. But doing so, I would not cast stones in another man or another, or yet another who did in their darkest moment, only what any man would have done to protect his life, or his child, or the children who are his life. And yet here you are, stealing my daughters who are more than life to me, who are staff and sight and soul.
Enough of words. The captors speed away while we, the victims, stand debating here. Show us the trail, Creon, and I'll attend you that we may soon discover where this man's daughters have been taken and how they shall be returned to him.
Nothing you command me can I here dispute. But once at home, I shall not forget that you have lifted your hand against me.
Threaten all you like, so long as you walk while you do it. Oedipus, stay here assured that nothing save my death stay my purpose to restore your daughters.
Heaven bless you, Theseus, for your nobleness and all your love and care on my behalf.
Oh, and the flying foe, turning on their attacker, soon will give blow for blow.
Hear the loud battle roar!
There I might find chance behold Theseus, our captain, Lord, meet with the robber band, rescue by might, and maim the captive maidens.
On swiftest steed or chariot, they shall overtake them.
They will be vanquished.
Dread are our warriors.
Dread Theseus, our king.
A vision rare tells me that soon again I shall behold Antigone and Ismene.
Soon they shall be returned to their father that loves and needs them.
Today, Zeus, worketh some great thing.
And this shall be a day of victory.
All-seeing Zeus, Lord of Heaven, to our guardian host be given might triumphant to surprise the foes and win their prize. Hear us, Zeus, and hear us, children of Zeus. Athena, undefiled, Apollo, prophet, Artemis, huntress, sister of Apollo, who the dappled swift foot deer over the woody glade do follow.
Help your twofold power, Athens, in danger's hour, and escort the maids home.
Father, would some god might grant you eyes to see this best of men who brings us back again.
My child, are you both back again indeed?
Yes, save my Theseus and his gallant followers.
Come to your father's arms, for let me feel a child's embrace. I never hope for more.
We come together both.
My precious nurselings, props of my age, I have my darlings, and if death should come, death were not holding me. Cling to me, press me close on either side. There, rest you from your weary journey. I pray you, Theseus, do not wonder if the sight of children, given over for lost, has made me somewhat ridiculous. Full well, I know the joy I have with them is due to you, the sole deliverer. The gods deal with you after my desire, with you and them and this land.
I would be famous more by deeds than words. Of this old friend you have had proof. My oath I have fulfilled and brought you back your children alive and nothing harmed for all those threats. But of a matter that has lately chanced on my way back here, I fain would have your counsel.
What is it, son of Aegeus?
To set a man, no countryman of yours, but of your kin, has taken sanctuary beside the altar of Poseidon, where I was at sacrifice when called away.
What is his country? What's the suit his prayer?
I know but one thing. He implores, I am told, a word with you.
What seeks he, if a suppliant something grave?
He only waits, they say, to speak with you, and then, unharmed, to go upon his way.
And marvel is this petition.
Think, if there be not any of your kin at Argos who might claim this boon of you.
Oh no, my friend. I will not see him.
What ails you now?
Ask it not of me. I know the man of whom you speak, and he is hateful to me.
Explain.
Your words have told me who the suppliant is. My son, your king. My hateful son, whose words of all men's, except maybe his more hateful brother, would jar upon my ears.
But you must listen. If his suit offend you, no need to grant it. Why so loath to hear him?
That voice, O king, grates on a father's ears. I have come to loathe it. Force me not to yield.
But he has found asylum. Fail not in due reverence to the gods.
Oh, heed me, father, though I am young in years. Let the prince have his will, and for our sake also let our brother come. If what he urges tend not to your good, he cannot surely rest perforce your will. To hear him then, what harm? By open words a scheme of villainy is soon betrayed, but Polyneices is no such a villain as he would seek to harm you. After all, these many months, did he not shelter Ismene in his camp, and let her come to us when necessity warranted? Father, listen to him. Other men like you have thankless children and are choleric, but yielding to persuasion's gentle spell, they let their savage mood be exercised. Look you to the past, forget the present. Think on all the woe your sire and mother brought you. Of evil passion, evil is the end. Do not repeat their mistakes. Yield to us. Just suitors should not need to be importunate, nor he that takes a favor lack the grace to make return.
Grievous to me, my child, whom you win for my beauty. Let it be then. Have your way. Theseus, if you must come, I beg you, friend, let none have the power to dispose of me.
No need, sir, to appeal to me a second time. It likes me not to boast, but be assured, your life is safe while any god saves mine.
Who creates excess of days,
thwarting the common grounds of life?
I judge that man a giddy wight who walks in folly's way.
For the long years heap up a grievous load,
can't pleasure heavier pain till not one joy remains.
For him who lingers on life's weary road.
Father, methinks I see the stranger coming.
Lo, he comes, and weeping plenteous tears.
Who may he be?
Polyneices. He is here.
Ah, me, my sisters. Shall I first lament my own affliction, or my aged sire's, whom here I find a castaway with you in a strange land? An ancient beggar clad in tatters marring all his frame, while over sightless orbs his unkempt lock float in the breeze. All this too late I learn. Wretch that I am, alas! I own it, and I am proved most vile in neglect of you. I scorn myself, but as almighty Zeus in all he does has mercy for the co-partner of his throne, let mercy, Father, also sit enthroned within your heart. For transgressions past may be amended, though they cannot be undone. Why silent? Father, speak! No, turn away! Have you no word for me? Will you dismiss me then in mute disdain, nor tell me why you are so angry? Oh, sisters, mine to you this obstinate silence try to move. Let him not spurn without a single word of answer me, the suppliant of a god.
Tell him yourself, unhappy one, for large discourse may send a thrill of joy, or a stir of cord, or of wrath, or tenderness, and to the tongue-tied somehow give a tongue.
Well do you always counsel, Antigone, and so I will speak out. Father, let me tell you why I came. I have been banished from my native land because by right of primogeniture I claim possession of your sovereign throne, wherefore Eteocles, my younger brother, ousted me. Not by weight of precedent, nor by the last armament of war, but because I graciously let him take the throne first for a year, and foolishly thought he would return it to me. I brought an army when words alone would not win back what I had lost, and Creon's son did slay himself to turn my purpose aside. One more year did I give Eteocles, and when I returned to ask my due again, one more time did he deny me. The people love him not, but he holds them in their thrall, and me they love less because I made war upon them, but this I would not do except that I am forced to. And the prime cause of this, I deem, is the curse that rests on you, Father. Why then, do you ask, am I here today? Father, I come a suppliant, both for myself and for my allies, who now, with squadron sevens beneath their seven spears, once more, and for the last time, encircle all the plain that encompasses Thebes. I, but the bastard of an evil fate, lead against Thebes that fearless Argive host. Thus by your children and your life, my sire, we all beg you to remit your wrath and favor the one who seeks a just revenge against a brother who was banned and robbed him. For victory, if the oracle speak true, will fall upon the one who has you for an ally. And sure enough, the people of Thebes would rather have you than I, or Eteocles, or Creon. But of all four of us, I alone am fit to rule. I alone am whole in body, heart, and soul, uncorrupt and unblemished. So by our fountain and our familiar gods, I pray you, yield. Here, a beggar I, an exile, you, an exile, likewise, both involved in one misfortune, find a home as pensioners, while the lords of Thebes, oh agony, make mock of you and I. I will scatter with a breath that upstart's might and squash the fraction that Creon's leads, and I will bring you and my sisters home again and establish us once again as the first family of the city. This with your will, I with good will undertake. Without it, I can scarce return alive. Please, Father, please say that you will back me, and let us raise our standards together.
Nay, Polyneices. Nay, never again will you hear my voice. Oh, villain! Have you had the sovereignty that now your brother holds instead? Would you not drive me out just the same? Nothing is here for tears. It must be borne by me till death. And I shall think of you all as my murderer. Eteocles thrust me out, but when I came to you in Argos, you would not have me either. So I baked my bread in a strange land. And had not these, my daughters, tended me, I had been dead for all aid of you. They tend me, they preserve me. They are men in true service to their sire, but you are bastards, and no sons of mine. Therefore, just as heaven has shut its eye on you, if indeed these banded hosts are moving against Thebes, then you shall fail for that city. You can never storm, but first shall fall! You and your brother, bloody brood! Such curse I scream against you both! Such curse I now invoke to fight for me, a sightless father who begat degenerate sons! And my curse is stronger than your throne or your suppliants! If by right of laws eternal primeval justice is enthroned by Zeus, begone! Abhorred! Disowned! No son of mine, vilest of the vile. Worse than your brother, for at least he does not shame himself to beg a boon of me after all he has done and not done. On the ancestral gloom of Tartus, I call to snatch you hence! On these dread goddesses I call, and Ares who incensed you both to war on one another. Go now and proclaim what you have heard to the Thebans all. For I love them far less than I ever loved you. And so I give them only this, the heritage that Oedipus divided and relinquished at last to his sons.
And so I have your answer. Woe to my journey and my baffled hopes. Woe to my comrades, what a desperate end to that glad march we laid from Argos. Woe is me, woe to my sisters, who've hurt our father, and woe to Thebes. And most of all, woe to my father, whose soul is like his sight, plucked from its place with his own hands.
Polyneices!
What do you say, Antigone? Say on.
There's still a chance. Turn your back on your host to Argos with all speed! And ruin not yourself and Thebes as well.
Oh, that cannot be. How can I lead again an army that's seen me quail?
But, brother, what profit from your country's ruin
comes? No, 'tis a shame to live in exile. I, the elder, bear a younger brother's faults.
Who you bring to pass his prophecies, who threatens mutual slaughter to you both.
Aye, so he wishes, but I will not yield.
Woe is me. But say, will any dare, hearing his prophecy, to follow you?
I shall not tell it. The good general reports only successes and conceals mishaps.
Misguided youth, your purpose then stands fast.
'Tis so, and say me not! The road I choose, dogged by my sires and his avenging spirit, may lead me to ruin, but for you, sisters, oh, may Zeus make your path bright. Now let me go. Farewell. A long farewell. You may never see my living face again.
Hide me!
Bewail me not.
Who would not warn you, brother, hurrying to an open pit?
If I must die, I must. It rests with fate. For you both, I may pray that heaven, you may escape all ill, for you alone are blameless in the eyes of all.
Ills on ills!
No pause or rest!
Come they from the sightless one?
Or haply now we see fulfilled what fate long time ago ordained?
Never have proved vain aught that the heavenly powers will.
Time, with never sleeping eye, watches what is writ on high.
Overthrowing now the great, raising now the meek.
Children, my children, go summon hither Theseus, my best friend.
And why, father, do you summon him?
To bear me anon to Hades. Send him, tarry not.
How know you it is time?
I know full well. Let someone with all speed go summon hither the Athenian prince. For all his benefits I would perform the promise made when I received him first.
I saw your son depart in tears. I assume the interview went not well?
Never mind, dear prince. For your presence is much wished for, and sure some god has bid good luck attend you on your way.
What son of Laius do you need from me now?
My life has turned the scale. I would do all I promised you and yours before I die.
What sign assures you that the end is near?
The gods themselves are heralds of my fate. Their appointed warnings, nothing fails.
I must believe you, having found your prophet true. Then speak what must be done.
O son of Aegeus, for this state will I unfold a treasure age cannot corrupt. Myself anon, without a guiding hand, will take you to the spot where I must end. This secret never reveals a mortal man, neither the spot nor the whereabouts it lies. So shall it ever serve you for defense. Better than native shields or near allies. Thus shall you hold this land inviolate from enemies. But to the spot the god within me goes. Let us no longer hesitate. Follow me, daughters, this way. Strange that I, whom you have led so long, should lead you now.
If immortal prayers are heard in hell, Hades, goddesses, dread, invisible. Monarch of the regions drear, Hecate, hear, oh, hear!
By a gentle tearless doom, speed the stranger to the underworld.
Let him enter without pain,
wrongfully in life tortured, be he now by justice blessed.
Friends, countrymen, my tidings are in sum that Oedipus is gone, passed away from life to death. How he grew tense, you saw him and must know. Without a friend to lead the way, himself guiding all. So, having reached the abrupt, earth-rooted threshold with his brazen stairs, he paused at one of the converging paths, hard by the rocky basin betwixt that rift and the hollow pear tree of the marble tomb. He sat and loosed his beggar's weeds, then calling to his daughters, bade them fetch running water, both to wash withal and make libation. So they brought what their father made, and then washed and dressed him with observance due. When he had his will in everything, and no desire was left unsatisfied, it thundered from the netherworld. The maid shivered, and he folded his arms about them and said, "My children, you will lose your sire today, for all of me has perished, and no more have you to bear your long, long ministry. A heavy load, I know. And yet one word wipes out all score of tribulations. Love. And love from me you had, from no man more. But now must live without me all your days." So clinging to each other, sobbed and wept, father and daughters both. But when at last the moment, there was silence. A voice that summoned him. "Oedipus. Oedipus, why tarry we? Too long your passing is delayed. But when he heard the summons of the god, Oedipus prayed that Theseus might be brought. And when the prince came near, clasped his hand. We tenderly led the maidens on their way, not looking behind us as the prince and king walked the other direction. Till finally it overcame us, and we looked again, and lo, the man was gone, vanished from our eyes. Only Theseus we saw with upraised hand, shading his eyes as if from some horrible sight that no man might endure to look upon. A moment later, we saw him bend in prayer to the earth and prayer to heaven at once. But by what doom the stranger met his end, no man save Theseus knows. For there fell no fiery bolt, nor whirlwind from the sea, but he was taken. Was a messenger from heaven, or else some gentle, painless swallowing from earth. And without wailing, or disease, or pain, he passed away, an end most marvelous. And if to some my tale seems foolishness, I am content that such would count me a fool.
On this sad day, we sisters of one blasted lineage must bow beneath the shock, must weep and weep the curse that lay on him, our sire, for whom in life, a lifelong world of care, it was ours to bear, ah me! On us the night has come, the night of mourning. Where shall now we roam, over land or sea, in our distress, eating the bread of bitterness?
I know not. The death might stop my breath and let me share my aged father's fate. I cannot live a life thus desolate.
Best of daughters, worthy sisters, what heaven brings you needs must bear. Fret no more against heaven's will.
Love can turn past pain to bliss. What seemed bitter now is sweet. Ah me! That happy toil was sweet. The guidance of that dear blind step. But you speak true. His fate is even as he planned. He died, so he will, in a foreign land. Left in kind earth, he sleeps his long last sleep.
Alas, my sister, what new fate now befalls us orphans desolate?
What else, sister? Let us back again to Thebes.
Why return?
My soul is fain to see that earthy bed. Lead me thither. Slay me there!
Don't say such things. How shall I, unhappy, fair, friendless, hapless, how drag on a life of misery alone?
Fear not as may. How again to get us home, I know not. And we have no home. But in Thebes is yet some family that might be glad to see us. And we may yet heal this mortal feud, and stay the self-wrought doom that drives our brothers to their ends. If you come with me, I shall do my best to live on a while in your company.
Where go, good daughters of Oedipus?
To seek some destiny beyond this land where now their father sleeps.
May they go in peace and wail no more. Let sorrow rest. All is ordered for the good of heaven and earth.
By Aeschylus, directed by Sarah Judge, who I believe is the
audience.
And Antigone by Sophocles, directed by Amy Claire Tasker, who I don't think
is not in the audience.
Both terrific plays that bring this whole crazy cycle to a close. And also, again, you know, we have new events happening every single month of the year in the bar space. I want to acknowledge also Dan and Les Cowan, who performances, jazz every week on Sunday, Beatles karaoke, tons and tons of things almost every single night of the week. So you should keep coming back here, even when Theater Pub is not happening, to support them. Lastly, one thing we try to do since Theater Pub started is to A, never turn anybody away at the door, and B, always pay anybody who comes to collaborate with us a little something, you know, beer money, to show our gratitude. And of course this means that we need money to do those things. So if you feel like you got a little bit more than you maybe initially gave for tonight, Stuart will be passing around the donation jar. Your support, really the smallest donations make a huge difference for what we're able to do this year. We've staked out a very ambitious season, and so far things have been going terrific, but we need that continued support. So any little money you have, you know, $5,000, $6,000, we're going to take some time here to reassemble the bar, get the pool table back operational. We hope you stick around, have a few more beers, and talk to the cast and the rest of the Theater Pub people. Thank you.